Welcome to Developing a Woman and Girls Club Strategy. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. My name is Rachel Miller and I am club developer for Devon and Cornwall. I've got some colleagues joining today. We've got Dave Larham, who covers Buckinghamshire, Berkshire and Oxfordshire. Ben Smith, who covers Somerset and Dorset and Wilts. And we're joined by Vicky Alexander, who is the new growth activator role for the South. You'll be hearing from her at the end of the webinar, so you'll be able to have an update on her role and some exciting things to come. To start with, we have a quote from Albert Einstein: insanity, doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. We feel this is really relevant for where we are currently, and that there's a need to do things differently to ensure the progression and succession of women and girls rugby. So this tonight is the very start of it. We're just dipping our toes into the water to start having those conversations and thoughts, which sometimes can be challenging, to ensure that we continue to push forward and move on. The webinar is relevant for all, regardless of where you are on your rugby journey. It doesn't matter if you've got a full women and girls section, just women, just girls, or if you don't have a female section currently, you'll still be able to take bits of information from this evening. So it's absolutely relevant for you all. Also aware that there are different counties joining us this evening, so not just from the Southwest. You're all welcome and it's really nice to see you all, so thank you. So the outcomes for this session, although we're very much focused on the female journey, it's really important that with the thoughts and conversations that we're going to have today, that they're embedded within the whole club strategy. So your Women and Girls Action Plan or strategy, which we're going to start this evening, should collaborate and be integrated within your whole club strategy. And that's why I think it's really important that some of your committee hopefully are joining you today so that they can hear some of the ideas that you have and the progress that you want to see within your section. We'll also start to have a look at the vision, and that might mean creating it for you, you might not have one, which is the what, and then moving on to the mission for your female rugby at your club, which is the how. Finally, we'll be looking at the next step. So what are you going to put in place? What are you going to take away from this evening and start to do to be able to achieve and deliver this at your club? As I've said, this is very much the start, and then this will take time to be able to deliver and achieve. So we're going to start with a video from Chester Rugby Club about growing the girls game. I think this is hopefully going to start to bring it to life and give you an idea of what we're aiming to achieve by this webinar. And it's a really good example of that. So fingers crossed, technology doesn't fail and it plays.
My name is Sabrina McGill and I am the Women and Girls Lead at Chester RUFC. When we first started with the women's section, we used word of mouth and posters to promote the new team. We had a couple of attempts to start girls rugby, but the first efforts were unsuccessful due to a lack of focus and marketing. An Inner Warrior event was a breakthrough for us, using social media and local press to ensure we were reaching out to the wider community. From this, our Demons, girls aged 5 to 10, were born. A designer friend helped with the creation of a brand for us, giving us a look and feel for our artwork to provide consistency across the women and girls sections. This gave us an identity and our members were involved throughout the whole process. Now most of our focus is on social media and giving people insight into how we work, what's on offer, and how to find out more about getting involved.
So I think the really great thing about that video is it's incredibly relatable. They're really honest in saying that they tried certain things which didn't necessarily work, and that's absolutely going to happen on your rugby journey, and it's not a problem. The most important thing to do is take a step back, reflect, look at your strategy that we're hopefully going to start to create this evening or start to think about, and have a new focus. What do you want to do next and what do you want to achieve? And by doing that, Chester were able to achieve success. because they took that step back and had a review. So I think that was a really great video to show that it's all right to make those mistakes. You're going to learn from them. And as long as you have your strategy, which is going to keep you on task, you will then be able to move on and achieve success. So let's talk about the vision that we've started talking about. So this is very much the what. It's usually one sentence. It's quite broad, doesn't have a huge amount of detail. And it's about what the club wants to become, where the club aspires to be in the future. And again, a lot of the words around it are inspirational and aspirational. So what are you looking to change? What are you hoping to achieve in the future as a club or as a women and girls section? We've included our Women and Girls Action Plan, and the vision for that is a successful and thriving game across England. And this is the same vision that we have for our wider England rugby as well, which just proves that if the women and girls section and the England rugby have the same vision, we're all working to achieve the same thing. I think it would be beneficial if the women and girls section at the club, as well as the wider club, had the same vision. So you're all working and striving towards achieving the same goal and the same vision in the future. Then when you dive down into the mission, and the principles, the wider section, that's when things will start to change and alter, and your information and where you hope to be might be slightly different to the wider strategy. But the vision overall, that one sentence, can be the same thing, and I'd advise for it to be the same thing for your club. So we're going to break out into rooms now for 10 minutes, and this is the start of that vision discussion. Your club might already have a vision that you know, which is great. So is that something you want to take on as the women and girls section? If not, if you want to have one that's slightly different, it'd be good for it to align with the club's vision. It might be that you're not aware that your club has a vision, or you know it doesn't have one. So this is your opportunity now to start having a think about it, having a think about the inspirational words that you want to utilise for your vision. And then we're going to come back in 10 minutes and hopefully share some of those ideas and see where we've got to, which I look forward to. So you should be put in some breakout rooms shortly. It would be really good to hear about some of your discussions. So if you're happy to share, if you've got a vision, a part vision, just some words that you know you want to use in your vision, if you could comment on the chat where you've got to or some ideas that you've had, that'd be really good to see. Out of interest, if you could just, if you've got your video on, raise your hand, or if you haven't, if you're happy to use a reaction, who knew if their club did have a vision or not? Just raise your hand or put a thumbs up or a reaction of some sort. That's good. So for those that didn't know if their club had one or aren't aware that their club does have one, it's really interesting because you're then not promoting to the wider community or individuals who are looking to join the club where you're looking at heading as a club, what your vision is, what you're trying to achieve, what you want to do as a club is not then visually out there for anyone else who's looking to join the team. And I think that's really important for players who or volunteers or anyone who's looking at becoming a part of the club, for them to know what your club vision is. So if you aren't sure, it'd be really interesting to go and find that out. Or if you think your club doesn't have one, it might be that opportunity to have that wider conversation and come up with one together. Oh, why can't I move? There we go. Moving on to the mission now, which is the next part. So this is slightly larger than the vision. It's a couple more sentences, and it's the how. How are you going to achieve it? What do you want to do? So if we go back to the women and girls statement, our objective or our mission is to deliver a plan to accelerate the women and girls game and create long-term value. So we've sort of got two things that we're trying to achieve there in our mission. Oh, skipped a page. So I know this looks like a lot of information, which it is. We will be following up with this demographic as part of the email. And those black boxes are actually hyperlinked to that section to give you more information. So you can really deep dive and get to go into those bits more in depth by clicking those links. We're not going to do that now. We don't have time. But ultimately, this page here shows the female player pathway and the journey that they have, depending on whether they come in at the mini stage or throughout their rugby career. It doesn't matter. But this is the infrastructure required to support female rugby and the pathway. And as you can see, it's a lot. So hopefully in the future, when you're starting to look at your strategy and pulling it together, this can be a really useful tool to think about those areas that you really want to focus on or think that they might be a bit of a weakness. You can then find out a bit more information to make sure that you can make it potentially stronger and ensure that the female journey is really well supported. We have created a women and girls role description, which your club is more than welcome to use. We will be sending it out. But equally, it's really important that you have that conversation with your club about what their expectation is of your role, what they're looking for you to achieve with that role, and then where you want to take it yourself. So this is quite broad, just a template to use, but it's definitely important to have that personable conversation with your club as to what they're looking for. And as the last slide demonstrated, with all the different areas of support, it's really important to identify an individual or group of individuals who are going to take this strategy forward, who are going to make sure that it's achievable and that you're progressing with the strategy to ensure that you continue to grow your women and girls game at your club. We know that the Women and Girls Lead is getting larger and larger, so there might be the opportunity that you break down the role slightly and introduce other roles to ensure that you don't have that volunteer burnout and it's not too big of a task for an individual. So another role that we've created is the player experience coordinator. This doesn't necessarily have to fit with just the women and girls side either. It could be a across the club role, but again, it might assist in making it more manageable. So this is another role description that you might be able, that you might want to take away with your club. Or again, it just enables you to start thinking about how you might want to break down that women and girls role so it's not such a large thing, and how maybe you can pull together a group of individuals who are willing to take forward the strategy to ensure that it progresses and that it's not just a piece of paper that you've created. So we're going to go back into our breakout rooms now. We've done the vision, or we've started to think about the vision, and now we're moving on to the mission. So like we said, it's a couple of sentences, it's more actions, it's more how we're going to do it. So we're going to give you another 10 minutes to follow through on that next part now. So you should be going into your breakout room shortly.
It's got into a rhythm.
Oh, sorry, that always happens, doesn't it? 10 minutes just is never enough. I know, it was just the start. Hopefully you're all back in the room now. And had some really good conversations. If, again, you are happy to share, it doesn't necessarily have to be the mission, it doesn't have to be fully pulled together, but if you could comment in the chat, maybe some of the discussions that you've had, or if you have got a mission together, or maybe even part of the mission, if you're happy to share that in the chat, in the comment section, that'd be really helpful to know sort of the conversations that you had within the rooms, because I'm sure they've been really helpful. Share. Thank you, Mike.
Yeah. Do you want...
Timothy, hi.
I think one of the things we sort of come across is the fact that we, you know, clustering is one of the more important things out of the whole thing, and trying to break down local rivalries so you're happy to cluster with and train with and whatever with other local clubs where you've always had that rivalry where you're worried about losing players to them and stuff. So it's sort of turning it more into a community rather than being so anti each other, you know, on local terms.
Oh, thank you for sharing that. I'm really pleased you've had those conversations, because you're exactly right. You're all aiming to achieve the same thing. And we're at a point in the game where sometimes we're not able to do that as one club. So to assist, you do need to cluster. And ultimately, all it's going to do is benefit your players and the experience that they're going to have. So, yeah, I completely agree with that. And it looks like a lot of others agree with you as well.
So something we did in Cornwall was we actually had a map of Cornwall with all the clubs on there, their training times. And then all of us have sent it out to wherever we can on social media. So it's not an individual club doing it for themselves, it's all clubs doing it for all clubs. And, you know, that has certainly helped us.
Oh, brilliant. I'm glad to hear that that's been successful. Yeah, as you just said, we're ultimately trying to achieve the same thing and support each other, hopefully, within our areas. So I'm really pleased to hear that that's worked for you and hopefully maybe some takeaway for other areas. Point here about saying ensuring girls and women's views are respected within decision making. Absolutely right. And hopefully with some of those role descriptions, it's going to enable those individuals in those positions to have the confidence to feel that they can speak up because they are able to do that on behalf of their women and girls section and hopefully create change and enforce change. So it's really important that one, that individual is confident to do that and understands that that is part of their role. Some really great points that we're sharing here.
I think, Rachel, as well, it's important that the women and girls section isn't a section outside of the club. It's important that it does align and is part of the club. And it's important for the other members of the club who aren't in the women and girls section to become allies to the women and girls. You know, I've seen a couple of times over the years where sections have been at loggerheads within their own club.
Mm-hmm.
And that never ends well for anyone, really. So the key part is to, for me, is to engage with some allies who can be on your side when you want to take things forwards, when you want to talk about, you know, training nights, when you want to talk about using facilities, when you want to talk about, you're looking at new kit for the club, are you engaging with the women and girls when you look at the new kit that you're going to buy for the club? So I think that's quite an important and maybe quite a simple thing that could be done.
Completely right. I think allies is such a key word to use there. And the more that we can have within the club, certainly the more helpful that it's going to be. I said at the start of the webinar, it's really key, although we're very much talking about the women and girls section here, that it's very much embedded in the wider strategy of the club. That's most important to ensure that your wider committee understand and realise that you are very much embedded and integral to the whole club. You're absolutely right. Whole club means whole club. I think this leads nicely onto the next bit. So thank you all for your contribution and continue to comment in the chat because it's really useful for other people to see your ideas and experiences and share them. And I will hand over now to Ben Smith, who's going to continue the webinar.
Good evening, everyone. So as we move ahead, and some really good points made by you, Steve, that we'll cover off in the next couple of minutes. But this is kind of a little model we call the balanced club approach, where we'll kind of help you build that plan. And within it is kind of the three sections. So you've got your people, your business, and your environment. And the best way to think about this is to think of it as a three-legged stool. And if you were to focus heavily on one section, i.e. if we were focused on the people, let's say, we kind of forget about the business and environment, and essentially that stall falls over. And that's the same with building this, your plans or reviewing it, is kind of have that balanced approach to what we're trying to build. So try not to take your eye off one section whilst trying to build the other section. And it kind of gives you that good steerance on where you might be going. Next one, Rach. Some good discussions as well in terms of we've looked at your vision, you're looking at your mission, what values underpin that. Obviously, we have treads with the RFU and how that kind of, what that looks like within the women and girls game. So you can see some examples of how teamwork, how respect, how enjoyment, how the discipline, how sportsmanship interlinks with the women and girls game, and how the values underpin the vision and the mission that we have. And also you can take away to your club. So I'll leave it up for a few more seconds just for you to read through. I won't read through the detail of each one, but it'll give you a bit of a flavour of how those values linked to your vision and your mission. Moving on into your goals, or how you set your goals, how you set your metrics. And I'm sure we've all heard and seen the SMART and how to build your targets. And the two I really want us to kind of think about when coming to build that plan or reviewing your plan that you got for your women and girls is the measurable part. And the temptation is when we're creating that plan or kind of reviewing it from the start is that we might get too task focused. And actually, is how you reviewing that measurable stuff, what's within that section okay, and what does that success look like? So really think about that measurable, thinking about the detail behind it and what that actually looks like. The second one I really want you to think about when going away, looking at your plans that you've got or starting to build them, is looking at who's agreeing on it. So is this agreed by the old club? Is this agreed by one person trying to do the whole plan? Who's agreeing these targets? Are you spreading that workload? How is it interlinking with the wider club plan on that? So as I said, I'm sure we've all come across the SMART targets. Two to really focus within your plans will be the measurable and the agreed part. The plan itself, how will you start to build it? So think of pillars. So we've got our vision at the top, we got our mission statement underneath, and then we've got five or six pillars that will fall underneath that will uphold that. Okay, and each club will have different pillars. That means different things to them and how you're going forward. Okay, and on the next slide, when we come to the second, we just give you a clear example of a club who have got a whole club plan and their different pillars that kind of fit within it. So if we move on to that, so you'll see on the screen now is Otley's plan. Okay, don't worry about this. If you're trying to zoom in on your phone or trying to look on the laptop, we'll send this out so you get a clearer picture of it. But as you can see at the top, you've got your junior, senior rugby within that. Okay, the one club ethos, and I saw from the comments earlier that the whole club means the whole club. It's got their vision at the top, the missions underneath, and obviously your pillars underneath. So your financial, sponsorship, relationships, rugby, facilities, members, and community. So they're the pillars that are building that vision and mission. And if you look within the rugby one, it's talking about grow and developing the junior section, and it's talking about establishing a women's rugby side. So again, how this all interlinks, I guess the question is to ask yourself is, if your club's got one, where's the visibility on it? How do your members see it? How do parents see it? How do you as a club keep the committee and exec committee and leadership teams accountable to this plan? If you don't have one, it doesn't have to be this busy. You might just have two or three pillars that you might just have some really key points that you're trying to achieve underneath that will help you then guide throughout your committee meetings and again, give some targets and some visibility on how this might look. Cool. So appreciate we've had two really quick breakout rooms. We've checked loads of information at you. And I guess the two questions that we will leave or we'll ask you now is, what action will you take after this meeting? And what support do you need from us, RFU team locally, and moving on up nationally? So if you feel free to check it into the chat box, or if you want to come off mic, more than welcome to. But what action will you take away after this meeting, and what support you might need? We appreciate clubs might be in different positions. You might be reviewing your plan at the moment. You might be starting from scratch. Again, different clubs on different journeys on building this plan.
Can I ask a couple of things on support? In terms of fixtures, so I know that our club, all the fixtures for the boys are already set. We haven't even started looking at fixtures for girls.
Okay.
Is that the case across all counties? Because it seems as though whatever we do is great, because we're obviously really invested in making this work for all of our clubs.
Yeah.
But it really does feel that the RFU are way behind what the clubs are actually trying to achieve. And no, also in terms of providing referees as well for the under 16s, 18s and 20s and things like that for the women's game and girls game. As a club, we're trying to get some of our older first 15 who are hopefully retiring at the end of the season to take up reffing courses to then come back and help out. But they're only really looking at helping out the Colts and the boys. So it's trying to engage them with the whole ethos of the women and girls side. But we need that really pushed by the RFU as well. So really driving home female referees, because the girls need people to look up to, because, you know, lots of fat old bald dads running around coaching is fine and we're doing everything we possibly can. But I've seen it when we have a lady ref that comes down occasionally, and it changes the attitude of the girls immediately. And it's brilliant to watch, and we need so much more of it.
Yeah, no, it's some really good points, and you'll definitely see over the coming weeks we've and there's two of them on the call tonight. I won't put them under the spotlight now because they've only just started in their roles this week. So you'll start to see a lot more in terms of women and girl growth activators, linking with volunteering, linking with competition. So all those points you just made, Stephen, you'll start to see a lot more coming from us in terms of the south of England and southwest in terms of those women and girls focus roles. And that's kind of linked to the Rugby World Cup impact funding. So you'll start to see a lot more. They've literally only just started last week or this week. We got Ficky, who's on the call, who were doing 5-10 minutes at the end, so you'll start to understand where those roles fit into and how you can access the support going forward. But it's a really good point and a really good model of practice, like you said, in terms of those older girls, getting them onto a referee's course, and if we can keep two or three of those in the game to come back and referee at the club, then they become those good role models and hopefully stay in the game.
Can I just say to Steve, yeah, to Stephen, I mean, that's a common theme across the men's and the youth section as well. There aren't enough referees across those. So it's not really something that is sort of purely about the women and girls game. The men struggle. I know there was one county, for example, with my sort of county hat on. It wasn't Cornwall, but there was one county who on one Saturday lost 18 men's games because they didn't have a referee. So, you know, it's not that people are stopping them from going through. It's just that there aren't enough referees, regardless of gender.
No, I appreciate that. It's just when there is a conflict, the men's teams will always get the ref and we won't.
I think the other point about the fixture thing, in Cornwall, and you may or may not know this, so I'll quickly let's say it. In Cornwall, they have almost like a speed dating session for the boys' sections, and they all meet up in one place, they all put out tables, and they all go around and organise their fixtures on one night as much as they can. That's right cosy, isn't it?
Absolutely, it is right. And this is what we want to try and do with the girls, is get them into the same sort of fixture meetings. But at the moment, as we're all aware that, you know, the clustering, we need to know the numbers of each age groups and things like that, so we're able to give them competitive rugby. I mean, it would be great if we could have, you know, the girls in those fixture meetings, and then we can set dates. So that is would be really, really important. Can I just come back to some points that you made about, you know, we need to educate all of these youngsters. So my 11, 12 and 14 year olds constantly saying to them, go onto the RFU website, look at the training courses that are coming up. You know, it's not just the head cases and all those sorts of things. Get them interested in coaching and the refereeing side of everything. So we're not just teaching them how to play rugby, we're also trying to educate them and look for resources and things like that. And that is what helps the youngsters with the Duke of Edinburgh Awards and things like that. They're useful tools. If we could have more free courses for younger players that might give them the idea of, oh, I could do a bit of refereeing and things like that.
Yeah, no, there are some really good points on that. We've taken notes, obviously recording, so we can go back over that. And when we send out our notes, if you feel that there isn't anything answered on, or you want to ask a few more questions, and please feel free to email us back. Just conscious of time and the discussions that we've had tonight, so we'll just move on to the next slide, if that's okay, Rachel. I know you've just been discussing what's the next step. So is that to continue the building your plan and finishing off your plan? Again, tonight, collaborating with wider clubs, and this is what the joy of running these kind of online webinars is about you at your clubs, representing yourself tonight, and then talking with other clubs to kind of discuss ideas that you've seen working, or to share best practice. So again, we'll try and link this all up after. And then how are you going to launch your plan? How are you going to bring it to life? How are you going to get that visibility on it moving forward? Just the details there. So if you don't know who your club developer contact is in the area, you can see the names up on the side there. Again, this will come out in the slide. Feel free to email us any further questions on building this plan, or as we discuss around the referees tonight and a bit more funding around courses. That's all being taken on board. So again, feel free to email us. And from there, I will hand over to Ficky.
Thanks, Ben. So my name is Vicky Alexander, and I have taken the role of the growth activator for South. So predominantly my role is going to be to try and enhance what is already being out there in the community, but also to grow, to sort of grow the opportunity and create opportunities for more girls to have access to rugby being put in front of them. So taking the traditional game and putting it in maybe a different location and then linking up with those clubs. But the idea will be to drive more participation in whatever that looks like, drive it through to clubs, and then hopefully the clubs will see the benefit of that going forward. So that's pretty much what my role will be in a nutshell. Next slide. Again, a bit like Ben, my details are on there. So if you would like to have a little bit more of a discussion around what I can do to help and support, I'm more than happy to have an email. So feel free. In regards to what has already been put out there, some of you will have seen some funding pots as part of the Impact Program. And there's already been the release of fundings for the under 12 packages, the grants for the facilities upgrades of the toilet packages and the sanitary packages. So that first phase has gone out. And the second phase, which some of you will be really happy to find out about, is about our coaching award vouchers. And if the next slide that we come on to, we'll give you some more information. So coaching award vouchers and the summer activity grants in order to try and help upskill some of our volunteers. Next slide. So the QR codes on there, if you want to right now, you can grab your phone. The QR codes are live. So when you take a picture of that one, you'll be able to activate the coaching award vouchers. And that will show you, give you more information about the coaching award vouchers and what they're going to be used for and how to apply for them. As far as the summer activity, the same thing, that little QR code does exactly the same thing. And you'll be able to see exactly what that grant can be used for. Specifically, it's to register new under 16, under 18 girls and trying to sustain that particular age group for girls rugby.
Vicky, can I ask a question?
Yes, go.
It's really a question that has been asked of me about three or four times since I've become more involved in this. And the question was, do the RFU plan on running women-only coaching courses? I've had it mentioned to me several times that women can easily feel intimidated when they have to attend a course with men as well. So is there anything on the horizon where there'll be women-only coaching courses run?
I think if you need women-only coaching courses, that would be something that you can discuss with the club developer or whoever's going to be booking your courses. I know from previous counties, they have run them and some have been really popular and some have just fallen flat. So I think it'll be on an ad hoc basis if it's something that your trainers can provide.
Okay, thank you.
Would that be right, Ben?
Yeah, no, I know it's something that Tim Pickard, the area training manager, he's looking at doing. It's just where we place them to maximise numbers and that. So it is on the agenda, it is being looked at.
That worries me, Ben, when you say that, because that says to me, and somebody in Cornwall is going to be placed in the middle of Birmingham. You know, we're right on the toe end of the county. And if you're going to put it in a place where it maximises it, which I really, really understand, I think we're going to get the short end of the stick on that one. And I wouldn't like that to happen. I'm sure that's not going to happen, is it?
I couldn't tell you, mate. Because like you said, like I wouldn't think that we would just host one that would be north and that would just be the case. But all I know is that area or that department are looking at the female only ones, where they're looking to plan them, etc. I do not know yet, mate. So again, we pass our feedback over to them in terms of where they might place them and that, but ultimately it's down to that department where they run them. But I can give you Tim's email, mate, to kind of link up with him.
Yeah, that'll be fantastic. I'll certainly do that. Thank you.
I've just seen that the vouchers are initially allocated to the women supporting girls rugby. So the majority of coaches I know are men who need the coaching as well. So, you know,
I think you'll find that as an initial, they'll be first distributed to females participating in those, but it won't be exclusive to them.
Okay, cool. Because I personally would really like to get as high up the coaching ladder as possible to, you know, just to benefit the girls.
Completely understand, and we shouldn't alienate the enormous advocates that we have within the women's game who are males. So all of that information is online at the moment. So you feel free, if you need to find more information, you can just message either the club developers or myself back.
So that brings the webinar section is now completed. We have got a QR code here to ask for feedback. You obviously don't necessarily need to do that right now. You are going to get this PowerPoint sent to you, so you can do it at a later date. But it's just to ensure, if you go right to the end of the slide, there is an opportunity that you can give us some feedback. We do understand that it has been a real whistle-stop tour this evening. And as I said from the very start, it was just to introduce you to the thought of creating a women and girls strategy, what that might look like, what kind of conversations and thoughts you need to start to have. We also understand that every single club looks different, the size of the club, how many sections they have, the amount of volunteers that they have access to, the facilities that you've got. So it's really important that you take away what's relevant to your club and also what's achievable. So the Otley example that we showed, we do have some other case studies that we'll attach to the post email as well, which shows how you can put it in a different format so it doesn't necessarily need to look like those pillars. And as Ben alluded to, it doesn't have to be six pillars, it can just be three, but they're really detailed and in depth and really achievable for the club, because it's really important that what you set yourself, you're able to progress and achieve to. That's ultimately what the strategy is for. But the aim of this evening was to just give you those tools and those thoughts so you can start to have those initial ideas. And now you can go away, have those wider conversations with your groups and your club to start utilising those templates and infiltrating that information to greater depth. And we are all here to support you in actioning that, and I'm more than happy to assist you with anything that you try to progress. I'm going to stop sharing my screen now, and we do fortunately have some time where we can open the floor up to some questions. I know you've already started to ask them, but there is some time now where you are more than welcome to ask those questions. If we don't have the answer to them right now, we are going to create a bit of an FAQ sheet from this evening that we will be able to send out as well. So if you miss any information or don't want to ask that question now, you can please follow up with us, and then we'll create a bit of an FAQ sheet so you have all the information that you've asked and obviously want to have. So if you want to come off mute, or if you want to pop a question in the chat, then we'll try to keep a look at both of those and hopefully answer some of your questions.